So it really hasn't been an issue. I think the conservatives have tried in some ways to make it an, oh my God, don't vote for the liberals because, you know, remember like the National Energy Program, and it's like people are going to the national what? Except in the province of Alberta where you get taught that from elementary school forward. You know, so they've tried to sort of say, well, you know, there's been hints of that this will be really bad, and you know, the what happened in Alberta with Rachel Notley is going to be absolutely disastrous, and they've doomed themselves and all of that. I'm not sure that that's playing terribly well. Voters really don't like to be told that they made a mistake and that they're not very bright. You know, oddly enough, that's not a good way. That's not a good way to get people to vote for you. You know, don't you know?
Or read your column.
There's that too. Right now, that's not going to be. I don't see it as a huge factor in this. They tried to paint both Mulcair and Trudeau as sort of anti-Western. I don't think that really, again, I don't think it resonated with voters.
I think Stephen Harper has done more to unite Canada than any previous prime minister, and here's why. He has gotten together every old person in this country to be angry at young people and the change in this country. I really do think this in some days. Earl Cowan is my new hero, because he is the voice of politics in this particular election. I honestly believe, whether you're an old person in the Maritimes, an old person in Quebec, an old person in Ontario or the West, you have a reason to vote for Stephen. And they focused on this because this is their strategy. So I guess what I'm telling you is I don't think it's regional alienation in the way it once was. I don't think we think collectively as we do, and I think probably the best example of that would be the Alberta provincial results, although there's so like many other factors as to why they kicked out Prentice and Redford and whomever else that they were voting against in Alberta and said, the hell with it, after 50 years, let's give somebody else a try. Maybe 50 years from now, we'll do it again. But I honestly think that in terms of the alienation right now, you're weirdly seeing an alienation of old people versus a changing country. Through immigration, through other ways, and it's basically being led by a lot of old people that kind of like to tell you that you're a right piece of shit.
Clearly, Maurice had all his problems lately. I don't think. I mean, it's hard to be alienated from a government you're elected. I think where you're actually seeing regional alienation is in Ontario. Right? I think the Liberal provincial government there has been campaigning closely with Trudeau because of that. And this has been a project that goes back 10 years within the Gatti government, that Ontario is not getting a fair deal out of Confederation. And maybe Atlantic Canada. So we may be in this weird, like, alternate universe where the Liberal government is based on two alienated regions that just don't happen to be the usual alienated regions.
Good, thanks. The last question is the question of the environment. Has there been enough attention to the issue of the environment in this election campaign?
No, and it might be the most regional issue of all the issues that are going on, because it is important in certain sectors. It's obviously hugely important in BC, where there is some chance of a Green candidate getting elected, not just Elizabeth May, but it might actually pay serious attention to it. There's been no debate about it. It's taken other weird forms in terms of the environment. One of the forms is obviously the pipeline. Yeah, absolutely. And I find that a little interesting in terms of the proxies for an environment debate in this particular country. So Quebec would be obviously another area where there is an environment debate, but we're not even calling it that. You know, it tends to be a stubborn "I hate the West" debate, and they're not going to, like the old people, get off my lawn sign. Same thing in Quebec, they're going to have that pipeline through my part of town. And no one is looking at it seriously, because no one ever looks at the environment seriously. It is a political issue, and I guess that's the unfortunate reality.
There's an interesting analogy for the environment that I use often with students. is, there's a debate amongst, around those of us who care about health and healthcare, that we need to always, we should be putting more attention on creating health and not treating sickness. Like that's always the what I do as a population health researcher is look at what is it, what are the social and economic determinants that make us healthy? And that's where our policy should be focused, that's where our resources should be focused, because it keeps people from getting sick as opposed to just treating them when they're ill. What happens in the health debate, that gets kicked off the every you put that out to people and they all go, yes, that's what we believe in. We want more health, not more health care. Until the debate comes, do I buy the machine that goes beep and invest in that, or do I put it in preventative programming and all of that that will pay off a decade from now? And we all choose the machine that goes beep. We all choose the health care, the sickness treatment. It's the same with the environment. We all say we really care about it. That's why it's the second most important issue. But when you put it up against, but it'll cost your job, or it'll cost you this in order to cut greenhouse emissions or whatever, or the price of gas is going to go up because we're going to put a carbon tax on things.
I mean, our and whatnot. Tribulator.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, I know. At the point where healthcare is going to be my big concern. But that's what we do, right? And so then all of a sudden, no, we don't want to pay the carbon tax. We don't, and so we say we care about the environment. We don't actually vote or act like we care about the environment.
And I think that's sadly the case, even though the Greens have won, run a very good campaign.
Yeah.
Elizabeth made it in the debates that she was in, probably the best of the leaders. They use social media very effectively. The party that makes it real mess up. So
yeah.
Okay, maybe we can take one more question. Yes, please.
Does the fact that we have polling stations in universities matter?
Yeah, good question.
You know, I really hope it does. You know, I think we've been part of it. Again, I'm the only one so far who hasn't told you to go out and vote, so I hope you went out and voted last week. And if you're not, that you go out and vote on Monday. I think that experiment of putting the polling stations on campuses, there are 39 of them across the country, both of the campuses, both U of S and U of R were part of this. I really hope this has changed some things that has got, you know, one of the things, and this is why, and again, Murray will hate me for this. I kind of like the idea of mandatory voting, partly because I like the idea. I think it makes voting a habit, and I think once you get into the habit of voting, when you vote early in your life, you tend to continue to vote. Once you don't vote for 20 years when you're eligible to vote, it's harder to pick up. So I think this has been a great experiment. The reports I get and from what I saw was that there were lineups to vote on campus. That's cool. Like, I'm just thrilled that that's true. You know, and the advanced polls have had these huge turnouts and the like. You know, I would like to think that this, in this day and age, there is no reason why we can't do that on every kind of university campus, and why you should not be able to walk into any polling station and technologically be able to vote in any riding in the country in which you can demonstrate that you are a resident. So I should be able to walk in on election day in Vancouver and vote in Regina, Wascana, because they go like this and they go, there you are on the list, and that's your ID, and that's a Saskatchewan driver's license. Here's your ballot. Right in your case. Yeah. There's no reason we shouldn't be able to do this across the country. But I think this is a great experiment that we got involved in. I'm sort of proud of you, UofR, that we got involved in this, and I hope, you know, I hope it shows that the students have actually taken it seriously. So.
Sorry, I'm totally ignorant. This is the first time you guys have had it here?
Well, we've had polling stations, where they've been early polls and where they've been allowed to be able to vote anywhere, any riding. So
is it just the advanced polls, or is it
There are polls on election day.
Yeah, you can vote your election day.
And there will also be polls on, but you've been able to do a write-in ballot anywhere, so if you're a resident from up north or from out of province, you can still do a write-in ballot on your home riding.
The first ballot, not anywhere for university.
No, that's right, yeah.
I guess the stupid question I asked, why the hell is it taking this long?
Yeah, that was, that is actually part of my reaction.
It maybe goes back to the incumbency question. I think one of the things that pushed Elections Canada into this was 2 years ago they had a change in their mandate, and they were no longer allowed to do voter education. So I feel that somebody must have gone, we still feel we kind of have this mandate to get not just university students, but they get their reserves as well, people who don't vote out to the polls. We can't tell them anymore how important it is. Let's just make it easier for them to actually do it.
Yeah. And this, again, this is another thing. There's been a big vote, a big push to vote amongst, a big debate about voting amongst First Nations populations. And I think the effort to put and get polling stations on reserves will have a big impact on it. Now, there's a real debate inside that community about whether you should or should not vote, and that I leave to the members of that community to resolve for themselves. I think Elections Canada, and you might be right, that they did this as an end run around, we're not allowed to tell you you should vote, so we're just going to hit you in the face with a whole bunch of polling stations and hope that you pick up the message that you should vote.
I would like to thank everyone for coming and asking questions, and I would like to thank our panelists for participating in this debate.
Wow, survived.